so much, and it's time for the talk by Stephen Wolfram. And the title is still a mystery, so we'll learn from him exactly the topic of the presentation. Well, we have to wait and see. Dr. Wolfram is the founder and CEO of Wolfram Research. He's the creator of Mathematica, the author of A New Kind of Science. Dr. Wolfram has long been a pioneer figure in physics and computing. His early scientific work, mainly in high energy physics, quantum field theory and cosmology, includes several now classic results produced during his 10 years at Caltech and Princeton. He has also served as professor of physics, mathematics, and computer science at the University of Illinois. And it's a great pleasure to have you with us today with the mysterious talk that we kind of, we can predict what it will be, but I think Wolfram Alpha will be involved to some degree. At least right. I would like to hear an update.
Okay. So, well, I've talked, thank you for inviting me again, Renata. So I've talked here a couple of times, I think, at least once. And I talked before I was sort of in the, talked about the possibilities of using computational knowledge to do useful and interesting things in medicine. I have to say that I'm still not ready to talk about what I think will be the most interesting part of that, which is directions of automated medical diagnosis. I hope I will have a lot more to say about that in the next 6 months or so. Instead, I'll talk about some other kinds of things. I've been lucky enough, despite what Marvin says about how nobody can ever do long-term R&D, I've been lucky enough to actually be able to pursue some fairly long-term projects over the last 25 years or so. Basically, I've worked on three kinds of things. A system called Mathematica, which gets used by lots of R&D folk and universities and so on to do algorithmic kinds of computation. Wolfram Alpha, which some of you, I hope many of you will know about, which gets used by millions of people every day to compute all kinds of things and gets used by other people to inside Siri and things like that to ask questions of varying degrees of interest. And the third big thing that I've spent a lot of time doing is building a new kind of science that people tell me has lots of potential relevance to medicine, although I'm less convinced about that. Maybe I should start off by, I want to talk about several of these kinds of things. I want to talk about a few new things that are like a week or two old that I thought you might find interesting. So just starting off on kind of what is this Wolfram Alpha thing, it knows about lots of kinds of things about the world. So let's say Marvin was asking what the life expectancy was in 1960. Let's see whether it knows what, so it's guessing we're talking about US life expectancy, and it says the answer was 69.9 years. There should be a plot somewhere. So this is that's the history of life expectancy in the US as a function of time over that period of time. So something good has been happening here. But this is sort of a typical example of the kind of thing that you can ask Wolfram Alpha. So you could ask it something like, you could say, you know, weather in Boston, let's try something, actually, let's try something. We can look out of the window and find out if it's true. That's sort of based on new real-time data that we're receiving continuously. You could ask it something like, where is the International Space Station? That's something which is sort of a combination of real-time data that's coming in and computations that have to happen to figure out, sort of solve the equations for the motion of the spacecraft, figure out where it is, figure out where it will be in the sky above Boston right now, figure out when it will next rise above Boston, those kinds of things. Or we could go and do something sort of more traditionally computational. We could say, you know, let's type in some random differential equation. Let's not make it so difficult. Let's say something like this, our differential equation in some kind of crummy notation. The Wolfram Alpha will try and sort of give us a report about this differential equation and solve it as best it can in this particular case and so on. We could go and say, type in some piece of the human genome or something, piece of a genome, and it might guess it's a human genome. Somewhere in here is my complete genome, but it's not accessible in the public version of Wolfram Alpha. It's there will be probably lots of other people's genomes in here as well, but But here it just did an exact lookup on the genome to find that particular sequence, and we can find out all sorts of things about, I don't know, we click on some random gene here, see what it can tell us about that particular gene, and we'll have all kinds of data about that, those kinds of things. Or we could go and, in the sort of the medical area, we could do something like we could say, you know, LDL 180 male, age 60, something like that. And what it'll do is go and look at some public health study and tell us where in the distribution of people of that age where that particular LDL value lies. So we can do all kinds of things like this and sort of slice all sorts of data that we have in real time. Here's something we'd really like to be able to do. So if I say something like, headache plus sore throat or something, I'd really like this to do something really interesting and good. It will do something, but it isn't that interesting and that or that good. It uses, in this particular case, it's using the NAMCS data set to be able to go and sort of slice down and find out for those particular symptoms, what are the probabilities for different kinds of diagnoses and so on. There just isn't enough data there to do anything terribly interesting. Somewhat frustratingly for us, this technology that we have, this Wolfram Alpha technology, it gets used a lot for operating on public data as a public sort of service kind of thing. We also have a business making custom versions of Wolfram Alpha for various kinds of large organizations, and we've done several projects for large healthcare organizations, both in the US and in other countries, using Wolfram Alpha, being able to do linguistic queries against those data sets and so on. And one can do fantastic things in diagnosis, but we can't show anybody the results at this point because it's private kinds of data. So anyway, that's what we'd like to be able to do. To me, it seems like diagnosis is sort of one of the most critical points in sort of the process of thinking about healthcare. If you get the diagnosis wrong, you're off doing very bad things. My kind of meta theory, which may be quite wrong, and it's just based on sort of at my level amateur knowledge, is that diagnosis is really pretty hard for humans, and it may actually not be so hard. And it's getting harder and harder for humans as there are more and more specialties to be considered and so on. And it may not actually be so hard to do something quite reasonable with computers. We're trying to do a lot of different kinds of things to sort of, in Wolfram Alpha, we try and cover lots of kinds of areas of knowledge, not just things related to medicine and so on. But in the medical area, for example, one of the slightly interesting things that we're doing, which will be ready soon, is taking the visible human data set and a tagged version of the visible human data set and be able to sort of ask linguistic questions about it. So you'll be able to ask, what nerve goes from the second finger and goes closest to such and such a bone or something. We think that'll be pretty neat. It's surprising that nothing like that exists already, but it's less surprising now that we've been into doing it because it's actually kind of hard. We happen to have in our underlying Mathematica system, we happen to have good 3D image processing capabilities and things like that, which allow us to take these buckets of voxels and do good things with them and make measurements of things and so on. So anyway, a little bit of background on sort of the basic Wolfram Alpha thing. I might mention something that has happened recently with Wolfram Alpha. We've been, in addition to being able to sort of deal with public data and sort of corporate data and things like that, one can also upload data to Wolfram Alpha, so one can go and upload a picture to Wolfram Alpha or something like that. Another sort of neat recent thing is the ability to connect Wolfram Alpha to things like Facebook. And so one of the things that has happened there is you can get from Wolfram Alpha kind of a big report on your life and times as seen by Facebook. And that's really small and really okay. That's just a version of my incredibly boring Facebook report, just made very small. Mine's boring because I don't really take my Facebook account very seriously. One of the things that's interesting, so individual people can get these kinds of reports for themselves, but as of a few weeks ago, we had collected a rather large number, because people have been doing this and we've been collecting anonymized data from them, we've actually got a rather large amount of data about people using Facebook. And so one of the things that's kind of interesting is to sort of do the pseudo public health or something study about those people. And those are some examples, those are really small, but those are some examples of networks, people's social networks, those are kind of like how people's friends are connected to each other. And you can ask all kinds of questions about sort of the typical Facebook user, like that's the distribution of number of friends for the users that we have. This is the distribution. This is as a function of age. This is the number of friends that people have on average. And so you see the teenage girls have fewer friends than teenage boys, I'm told, because they are, according to my older daughter, because they're more selective in who they accept as Facebook friends. But you see this a lot of this behavior here, I think, does not reflect true sort of societal characteristics. More it reflects the fact that Facebook hasn't been around for an infinite time. We can ask about all kinds of things. So for instance, here's a question we can ask. Given people of a certain age, what are the ages of their friends relative to their age? So what you see is that people typically have friends that are narrowly concentrated around their own age until they get a bit older and they start having kids, and then you start getting a second peak here, and so on. And actually, if you look in overall at the median age of friends versus age, you'll find it's pretty narrow for a while, and then it starts spreading out. Well, you can ask all kinds of other things from Facebook data. Like, for example, here's one that's kind of interesting. This is relationship status as a function of age. In other words, self-reported relationship status as a function of age, and the yellow part is single, and then the blue part is married, and so on. And you can kind of compute that as a function of age for those different characteristics for men and women, and so on. One question is, does this have anything to do with what's true in the population at large, or is this just some weird Facebook population that has nothing to do with anything? Well, you can actually compare with the Census Bureau data, and what was to me quite a surprise, you know, slicing down for US Facebook stuff and looking at the US Census and so on, the agreement is actually quite decent. There's a slight shift. You actually get less of a shift if you exclude rural population from the Census Bureau, but it's actually quite decent agreement between what you get from this kind of Facebook proxy for the census and the actual census. So the Facebook is the dotted line, the actual is the solid line here. So that's sort of interesting that one can actually do kind of a demographic study from Facebook. And sort of a fun thing to see. And you can look at other kinds of, then you can start looking at other kinds of things, like this is the median number of friends that people have by location. And so you see Iceland, for example. I wrote a blog about this a week or half ago or so now, and I got tons of pieces of mail from people saying the reason that Iceland has such a large number of median friends is because sort of everybody in Iceland is related, and it's a very small community. It's the same reason that decode genetics did well and, you know, could do its thing in Iceland and so on. But anyway, one sees all kinds of effects about the, I don't know whether this is population density, having lower numbers of median friends in the western part of the US or whatever, but it's sort of interesting to see these kinds of things. You can go on and look at other kinds of things from Facebook, like you can look at the migration paths of people from different hometowns to different residences between states, or you can see something which actually there isn't public data about because it isn't collected in a consistent way, the migration of people between different countries around the world. You can also compute that from this data. So you can work out all kinds of things, but it's sort of interesting to see. So these are things which are kind of at some very coarse level of demographic data. You can go to a much finer level. For example, you can look at people's wall posts on Facebook, and you can ask, what are they talking about? So we did that. And the meta point about all this was it only took 3 weeks to do this analysis. One person, 3 weeks. With our technology stack was what it took to do this, what I've shown you, and lots more analysis. So that was for me, the most important meta point about this. The analysis itself is also pretty interesting. So this was using natural language processing to just look at categorization of wall posts with different kind of categories. So those are just the words that were big for, as the identifying words for like health. You know, the word sick seems to be the word that's most commonly used to refer to things related to health. So now you can ask the question, as a function of age, for example, how do people's interest in these different topics change with age? And so, for instance, you see, career and money gradually ramps up, I suppose. Video games ramps down. People get more interested in the weather as they get older, which I didn't actually know, but I guess it's the case. And of course, health, you see ramping up. Interestingly, women lead substantially over men in terms of their interest in health consistently, but there's a gradual progressive increase in interest in health as a function of age. So anyway, I thought it's sort of interesting that one can see this kind of stuff, and it's really easy to get this data now from something like this data set that we have. Another thing that I've been involved in quite a bit, so this is sort of collective data about lots of kinds of people. You can also ask about individual data about individual people. So there's this whole area of personal analytics and quantified self and so on. And I've been collecting data about myself for a long time. In fact, I started probably 25 years ago collecting fairly detailed data about all kinds of things. For different reasons, I started adding, you know, things that tracked keystrokes, things that tracked motion, these kinds of things. For every one of the things that I started collecting for some good reason at the time. But the only thing that was notable was that I kept these systems working over the course of 25 years. So then about a year ago, I thought, okay, I better look at some of this stuff and see what one can actually see. So for example, there's the keystrokes. That's email sent as a function of from 1989 up to the present. This is a dot for every piece of email that I've sent. And so you can see, yes, I was working on my big science project during this time, and my sleep schedule went really bizarre. And for the last decade or so, I've been much more regular. And yes, I eat dinner at a certain time every day, all these kinds of good things. And like, for example, that's a similar map of keystrokes. And you can kind of work out, you know, what's the typical daily rhythm. So, for example, this is for the last few years. This is my daily rhythm that I'm probably slightly interrupting right this moment, not too much, but you know, lots of emails late at night, lots of steps taken early in the morning, meetings aligned at the hour and half hour points, those kinds of things. So it's sort of interesting to see this kind of information that you can get. And I think I was somewhat embarrassed to discover that I think I may be the human who's collected more data on themselves than anybody else, which I did not think would be the case, but. And there's all kinds of other types of data. Like I was working on this big science project, and I have the data about, you know, when did I modify each section of the book? When did I get things written? Or for example, I've taken all the paper documents that I have and scanned them all. And so the question you can ask is, when did I make paper documents? Oh, there's no scale here. That's bad. Well, I think it peaks in 1984. So that's the time when I kind of switched from being interested in paper to being interested in other kinds of things. So anyway, I think the thing that's interesting about all this personal analytics stuff. Oh, and I've been. This is my little social experiment. This is a little camera here that takes a picture every 30 seconds, and I've been kind of wearing it for the last month or so, most of the time. And it's sort of interesting to see what you get from it. And I've done. I don't think I have it here, but I have some analysis of sort of aggregate analysis of that. You know, you can do face recognition in it and so on, and you can find out who did you talk to, for how long, those kinds of things. There's a lot of data that you can get from these kinds of things. One thing we've been interested in is sort of all the data you can get from all the different kinds of sensors that exist, and so we've been kind of building a kind of generic analytics platform for taking data from all sorts of different kinds of sensors. Many of them, I could go through this long catalog of companies and places that are making medically related or medically usable kinds of sensors. It's sort of been interesting to try and make arrangements with all of them to try and feed all of their data into our sort of cloud for analyzing these things. I'm not sure. Did I already run out of time? No, I didn't run out of time. Well, okay, so one more topic maybe I talk about. This is sort of technology kinds of things. Let me talk just for a moment about basic science. Okay, so one of the things that I've been kind of interested in, well, we can talk a little bit about kind of the meta theory of medical diagnosis. You know, I say, we're interested in doing automated medical diagnosis, and some people say, medical diagnosis is just a bad idea. This whole notion of, you know, ICD-9, ICD-10, you know, classifying all these diseases is just wrong. They say there's just an infinite variation of different possibilities and so on, and you shouldn't be thinking about it that way. Well, so I think what I've kind of slowly realized is that probably the way one might think about these things is there's sort of an analogy to medical diagnosis for humans, which is diagnosis for large software systems. And so we've been sort of interested in, if you have a big software system that's running, maybe it's an operating system, maybe it's a server running something, it runs and it develops, it has problems every so often. Some random thing will sort of kick it in some way, it'll get some piece of data, some device driver will fail, these kinds of things. It will get sick, maybe it'll slow down. Eventually it will crash and die, and then you'll have to restart it for sort of from the same genetic material, the same program, and it'll have a happy next generation and so on. But so one question is there a theory? You know, we don't yet know a general theory of medical diseases and diagnosis and so on. Is there at least a theory of a case that should be a lot more tractable to us, which is a theory of kind of software disease? There really isn't. There's almost no work that's ever been done on this. There's a tiny bit sort of, you know, is there an ICD-9 for software ailments? Not really. There are tech support organizations that have a little bit of that kind of information. But it's not been, you know, properly set up of, you know, diseases of the memory subsystem and things like this. That's not a known thing in the field of software engineering. It's an interesting question. What do you do how do you check the vital signs for a software system? Well, you know, we run a large server infrastructure for Wolfram Alpha, for example, and so we actually have to do this. And we have very coarse ways of checking vital signs. It's, you know, memory usage, ping times. It's, you poke the server and you see what it does. It's very similar to what you do with humans, actually, in a way. But we don't have good technology. So we've tried thinking about, you know, how do you dig in really deeply and see, and so we can connect, for example, technically, we can connect, for example, we can make debug versions of all of our code, and we can just run a sort of specially instrumented version of GDB to just watch everything that's going on in the system. It's absolutely incomprehensible. You know, you're seeing you're seeing the molecules moving around down inside the system. I don't know how to do this. I don't know a good solution to this problem of sort of what do you measure in a large software system to find out it's healthy. And then the next question is, how can you classify, given that you find that things are going wrong, is there some way, perhaps automatically, that you can classify the different kinds of ailments that are happening? And then more interestingly, is there some way, in the case of the software system, that you can go fix these things? And what do you learn about what's fixable and what's not? So my best analogy for these kinds of things, sort of, I've spent a lot of time thinking about basic science, and the main thing that I've thought a lot about is the question of sort of, you know, when you try and analyze what happens in systems in nature, there's sort of this 300-year-old idea that sort of you use mathematical equations to describe systems in nature. I've been interested in kind of generalizing that and thinking about using programs instead of equations to describe things in nature, and I've done lots of work on that, and my favorite type of system is a creature called a cellular automaton. This is an example of one of those just black and white squares with a simple rule to say what color of square you'll put down next. The main thing that's interesting, so you know, in that particular case, there's the program at the bottom, there's what it does. The question is, what kinds of things can happen from programs that simple? And the main thing that's interesting and surprising is when you look at sort of the all possible programs of a very simple kind, you get lots of very different behavior. In a sense, it's a little bit like, you know, I imagine when one's going and doing pathology or something and looking at morphologies of different kinds of cells and things like that, I sort of imagine that, you know, you're kind of, as you change the program for these cells, sometimes you get a very small change, sometimes you get quite a big change. There's sort of a lot of diversity in what happens. But the most interesting thing is that some of these simple programs don't do simple things. They actually do really complicated things. Like here's an example of one that's called Rule 30, my all-time favorite. You run it a little bit longer, that's what it does. Even though the rule is really simple, the behavior is really complicated. And I think that's something that there are lots of systems in nature where things like this seem to happen. There are lots of systems in biology where things like this seem to happen. I've studied some that are kind of more on the morphological side of things. For example, one that I've studied a lot is mollusk shells. This is kind of a simple case of that, but it's perhaps interesting for biology in general. So one question is, you look at a mollusk growing and it has some differential growth process, and the question is, how do the mollusks of the Earth populate the space of possible parameters for this differential growth process? And one might have thought, oh, natural selection will have powerfully determined it's a particular, you know, particular mollusk. Actually, it turns out if you go into a mollusk museum and you say, do you have a mollusk with this shape or that shape? Every shape that isn't just closed up and leaving no space for the animal, they find a shell that's that shape. Although typically what's interesting is the mollusk curators will tell you very interesting stories about each of those shapes, and they'll say it's that shape because it gives it this special space to brood its eggs in and things like this. But in fact, it covers the space of all possibilities. And you see the same kind of phenomenon when you look at like pigmentation patterns, you start seeing sort of complicated things happening. I think the analogy of this with what happens in medicine is sort of interesting, because I think what one's ending up seeing here is sort of the spectrum of different possible underlying programs producing things which have great diversity of behavior. One can do certain kinds of classification, but ultimately there's great diversity in what's going on. In any case, I think my ultimate view of the kind of the, at least my as an outsider and amateur, my view of sort of the progress of the sort of the future picture of medicine, and this is my last kind of comment, is there's the, on the one side there's kind of data being taken with sensor-based medicine. Which sort of then, and the question is, one thing you can do with that sensor-based data is do a diagnosis and say, here's discretely, this is the problem, that's the problem, that's the problem. Another thing you can expect to do ultimately is to sort of parameterize the treatment just like the inputs are parameterized, and in effect expect that on the output end, you'll be doing algorithmic things here's what to do based on this, observed data. Here's the output, and some of that output may be from medical devices. Some of the output, there's a small company I happen to be somewhat involved with that's trying to make algorithmic drugs where actual molecules are programmable to do things. That's sort of the most interesting case, most molecular level case of being programmable. But I think it's more kind of like you imagine some sort of portfolio type, like you watch a stock portfolio or something, and you're asking. You're running some algorithm and you're saying, given what's actually happening in the world, what actions should I take to get the best results and so on. And I kind of, at least my meta theory of this, which is that's sort of the direction that one will eventually see things go in. And I should stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much.